Come on. Anybody has a question?
So the I doesn't want to refuse this, doesn't want to let go of the mind.
No, mind is, see, that let go will happen. The mind, the boss of the mind is buddhi, intellect. The intellect has to get clarity, okay? The unreality of mind. Okay? That only will help, finally. Finally, it's using the intellect, using all the logic which you learn in Vedanta, the intellect has to become sharp enough to recognize the falsehood. Once intellectually convinced, the intellect gets convinced, it will discard. Then, discarding one part, who am I? Okay? That question will push you back to the self. Drak drashya viveka, who is the seer, who is seen? That seer, who is the seer? That question will push you, take you towards the self. And that automatically drops the mind. And when our mind interferes, understand the real nature of the mithya nature of the mind, and who am I? I am the seer. So, using the right thought, you have to...
So, I understand. But then, going back to our question, how long do I have to keep sweating the mosquitoes?
Okay. So, yeah. So, that question will tell you. So many questions? No questions? Okay, see.
She has realized.
That's enough.
Yes. Your problem of sense is solved. Okay. So I'll take up our next set of questions. Okay. First, I said is clear about process of Nididhyasa?
Yeah.
The entire study of Vedanta scripture now is to sharpen your logic for what is mithya, what is satya. To get convinced that I am this thing. Because ultimately intellect is your boss there. Okay? The intellect should be used properly to remove other things. Then intellect should surrender to the self. Intellect also should not be there finally. Okay? That means use thoughts to remove wrong thoughts. Okay? And use the right thought to move towards the self. Who am I? Then stay silent. So you have to be able to stay silent longer and longer. That is called Nididhyasa. Okay? This is not samadhi, please understand. This is called sahaja samadhi. There's a difference between samadhi, which is obtained through jnana, it's called sahaja samadhi or natural. Here there's natural, there's no force. Okay? Very natural. Whereas there is yogic samadhi is there. There are yogic samadhis are seven types, eight types. Savitarka, nirvitarka, savichara, nirvichara, sananda, sasmita. Okay, there are different types of samadhis are there. The difference between yogic samadhi and this samadhi, in yogic samadhi also there is a bliss. Okay? There the mind is made silent using a mantra, using a japa or using a vigraha, using an idea. Mind is made silent in an object. Okay? There is an absorption of the mind. Mind is absorbed. For example, somebody watches a cricket match, India-Pakistan cricket match. Okay? So morning to evening, his eyes don't even blink. Ramana Maharshi's eyes also can blink one time, but this guy's eyes can't blink. He is in cricket samadhi.
Involved in that.
That's actually, samadhi is when you are involved and absorbed in something, it's called samadhi. But that's a temporary state of mind. Vedanta doesn't accept that as a realization. Even nirvikalpa samadhi is not accepted as a realization. Okay, most of the concept in the world is today, nirvikalpa samadhi you attend, you are made in your life. Nirvikalpa samadhi is a mental condition. Is it a good condition? Yes, it is helpful. It is helpful to remove your vasanas, helpful to focus on the mind. But is that ultimate? No. Ultimate is sahaja samadhi. Natural state. Okay. So this teaching here is for natural state, not for the nirvikalpa samadhi or savikalpa samadhi. You should not confuse. Tomorrow somebody says something else. Okay, this sahaja samadhi, naturally you should be able to, without any force, without change of lifestyle, without change of husband or wife, without leaving job, you should be able to attain samadhi.
Okay.
What is it? Okay.
Still
okay.
This problem.
Huh?
then this, still these problems will be there.
Which problems? Problems will be there, but you will be peaceful. Okay, so you have to please understand this whole spiritual literature is so cluttered with the new age teachings, then so-called yogic teachings, so-called gurus who teach. Please, you have to get a clarity. Vedanta doesn't say you have to make your mind blank. Vedanta says use your thought to remove the thought. Okay. Finally, the thought, there will be silence, and there will be deep thought that I am Brahman will be there. Okay. Without that thought, jnana is not there. Okay. But that's not ego thought. Then you reach Brahman. That's understanding that I am Brahman is there. Okay. I am Brahman is not ego. Ego can say I am Brahman.
Yes.
Okay. But then when you reach a Brahman stage, you understand I have reached. I am Brahman. Okay. That's a different thought. That's a thought. That's a very purified thought.
Is that a thought or not?
Ultimately, anything has to be. See, when you are in state of Brahman, there's
why
no thought.
That state? There is no
thought. But just before going that, you have come to that level, I am Brahman. Sat, Chit, Ananda, I am.
When you say that, that's a thought.
See, everything is, at the manifest level, there is a thought. Saguna Brahma level, there is thought. When you go to Parabrahma or Nirguna Brahma, there is no thought. But before going that, you are already clear. Saguna Brahma, pending account, you are clear. Are you clear? But that thought, ultimately that is required, otherwise mind will not be pure. Mind will not be purified. Okay. Mind is
using the thought to purify the mind. However, after that, you're transcending the mind.
Yeah,
there's no mind.
There's no mind. But when you come back, the mind is now already
purified.
You are coming back to the vehicle, which is purified. That's the point. Are you clear? So now the question here is, how many mosquitoes are there, and how long do you have to keep eating mosquitoes? So don't worry about the mosquitoes. Don't worry about how long, because the moment you bring in the question how long means tomorrow will come into picture. Survive for today, tomorrow we'll see. What is the guarantee that you'll be there tomorrow? Huh? So why worry about tomorrow? Whatever you're doing today, do it your best. Okay? So then, a realization is not something which you're acting. Realization is what you are. Okay? Your mind is distracted by so many things. Just get the clarity through teaching, which you have to do. That's why it is said, prescribed. Okay? Ajanma paryantam, ajiva paryantam. That means as long as you live. Okay? You have to do shravana, manana, nididhyasa. Because what will happen? The moment you start interacting with something will start accumulating. Okay? So, ajiva paryanta has two meanings. Please understand. As long as you think you are jiva, you have to do. The moment you realize you are Brahma, you don't have to do anything. But what will happen for us, householders, or anybody? You enter into this thing, then you start involving the society. Then again some dust starts accumulating. Okay? Which requires a cleaning up. So that's where this practice has to continue. Don't ask an end point. It's a continuous. Okay?
It's dynamic.
It's dynamic Brahman. Okay, then what will happen here is you have a feeling that I am not realized. So that comes from the mind. That comes from your vasanas, load of vasanas. Okay? Always, what's her name? See, how confident she says Pushpa. Did she say I am Atma Jyoti? Did she say I am Brahman? This Pushpa is very confidently comes. So what happens is that we are conditioned. That conditioning you have to start dropping. And what will happen here? We are living in the society. We are grahastha. This is a way of grahasthas. It is not a way of monks. So in monks what will happen? Okay. So they will have a title called Swamiji. So another Swami meets your Swamiji, Brahman, like that. Still says. So there's a reminder from outside. Here there's nobody who can remind you from outside. Okay? So it's a self-reminder. Understand? See, there's a difference between grahastha life and monk's life and householder's life. Householder's life, there's no outer reminder for you. Outer always there's a trap for you or pull for you. Okay? There's a difference. And it's very good actually. Okay? It's very good because in that process, the push and pull is there for the ego. The push and pull will loosen the ego. it's like a rubber elastic. One this side pull, the society. This side you push, then it will start becoming weaker, much faster than a monk's life. Okay? Really, the householder life is most beautiful and wonderful.
What are you talking?
You tell me, my dear. Sunday morning, leaving all the TVs, so many people are coming and sitting for Atmadhyana. Is that not a push and pull?
More than that, how we came.
How we came, Asa. Okay. See, there are a lot of misconceptions of spiritual life, okay? So for us, a monk's life, it looks beautiful from outside, okay? It's always, there's a saying, the green grass is greener on the other side. It only means that you are not observed or met, interact with the monks very closely. I have done that. Okay? One of my friends, one of my close friends, or one of my friends, I mean, whom I, my friend's friend, he was studying in engineering, BMS college. And every day he used to go and lecture, listen to a lecture nearby, Ramakrishna Mission. And by the time engineering completed, he realized that only realization is the only ultimate goal of life. Okay? And after engineering, he immediately became a monk. He said he struggled with his life for 35 years because the mental vasanas are not going. He stayed in Himalayas. Nothing is going on. Mind, struggling with the mind. Wherever you go, the mind is?
With you.
With you. Okay? So, just because, don't get fascinated or duped by the monk's life. Okay, lot of what is happening is, the lot of scriptures are written by monks. Okay, so they start very emphasizing the monk's life because they know that only. Okay, this is where this is different. This is a grahastha way of realization, householder's way of realization. And there is a beauty in that, there is a simplicity in that. Okay, the ego is I am the body, I am the mind. Right? If you become a monk and go to Himalayas, will that ego go? Okay.
It gets strengthened.
Yeah. What happens is that there nobody else is there to question. Here, the, by the grace of God, there's somebody called wife. Yeah. There's somebody called husband. every morning, your ego becomes a little bit. She has a needle pin. Puncture that. Whereas if you become a monk, who is there to puncture? Everybody is going doing namaskara. Okay. So that ego gets bloated. Okay. In householder life, the greatest gift is the ego can never get bloated. It gets punctured every day. So you should be thankful to your husband and wife. Okay? Such a surgical instrument has been given by God to you. The ego, take care of ego. The entire spirituality is. Okay? And
there is a new song in which he says, God has taken Kundasan, he has given me this mind.
What?
God has taken real Kundasan.
Kundas means what? Revenge.
He has taken revenge on me. He has given me mind. This God, nice revenge he has taken. Why did he give me this mind? You know, sometimes there's a lot of.
So when Guru enters, the remaining whatever little bit of ego is there, he will crush that under.
Crush that. So, what will happen here, householder's life, there's a lot of beauty in enlightenment, okay? Which people don't tell because their scriptures are written by monks, most of them. Okay, that was not the case. In earlier, it was written by householders, all rishis were householders. What happened was, in India, the time went bad. Okay, householders to have a spiritual practice as well as take care of their livelihood became very difficult. Then monks started taking over because they don't have a responsibility for household. Then all the scriptures got biased by monks' teachings. Okay, so that is not the reality. Reality is householder or monks, both are eligible for realization. And in fact, householder's life much more easier to attain realization. Because life is suffering, monk cannot understand. Every day morning you have to go to office. Every day morning you have to face the boss. Every day morning you have to face the customer. Come to the house, you have to face the wife or husband. So, life has the suffering. Anybody, Buddha has to tell you? Any scriptures have to tell you? So life itself, and if you live in a software industry, world is a maya is very understood. Every other every 4 months the job changes. Next day you'll come and say, what happened was my daughter was working in a company. She was a junior most employee, was just joined. And they started giving her a lot of work. And she started doing, working for 7 days a week and this thing. And seniors don't know that this is a new girl. They thought this senior girl, and they started dumping a lot of work and remove the job of the manager and give it to her also. So maya is like that only. Software industry, working in software industry, to understand maya is not very difficult. Okay. Living in the samsara is not really difficult to understand. Samsara is suffering. Okay. So ego is getting fried in one side anyway. Whereas in case of a monk, what will happen? The ego starts getting bloated. Okay. There's nobody to puncture it. It's a self-effort. It's very difficult. I'm not saying all the monks, okay? I'm speaking of, there are hundreds and thousands of monks, which is, I'm speaking the life of a secluded life. Then another thing happens is that in the secluded life, when you place secluded, you live in a secluded place like Himalayas, the mind starts creating delusion, especially the environment and all. Then somebody starts saying, I see God, I see this guy, and all those illusions will start coming. So read any books, okay? Very spiritual autobiography and all. There will be so much of illusion will be listed. The reason is simple. In a secluded place, mind starts creating. This happens in the prisoners are put in a so-called solitary cell. Within 15 days, they start hallucinating. Okay. So, in householder's life, you have a social interaction which stops you from hallucinating very easily. All hallucinations, you are brought down to earth. Very simply, okay? Suffering of life is understood. These are all very, very important conditions for realization. And read any book. They don't tell this because they don't understand householder's life at all. Okay? So what happens is this meditation, atmadnana, every day you do it, something, shravana, manana, nididhyasa, do it. That ego, one side will get pulled inside, other side will get fried outside. So that ego, it is very, very easy. Householder's life is very easiest way of enlightenment. Okay, the more you do nididhyasa, what will happen? The more the mind will become purified. The part of the mind which is responsible for what you call as eye sense. So that gets it. See, if you read any spiritual book, they are actually giving you wrong information. You say you should drop karma, you should have desire, then only you are really able to spiritual life. That's not correct. Because they are working at the surface level. If you work on this deep level, when the eye level, then everything else gets taken care of. Otherwise, if you exhaust vasana and one day you go for realization, it will never happen. Okay? You understand? So the whole teaching is, oh, the person has to have dispassion. It will never happen. Because you are working at the surface level. Here working at the deeper level. The eye sense you are touching. The more you touch the eye sense, this will start dissolving. You are touching the root of the problem. Once you cut the root, the tree falls. So that's why the more you go to nididhyasa, the mind, more mind gets purified at the deepest level. Okay, surface level vasanas will be there. And the surface level vasanas will take you something. Okay, then you will acquire something also. But as long as you keep doing this again and again, it will destroy the innermost, the core. Okay. If you go in a other way, where you, I'll exhaust all vasanas, then I'll start going spiritual life, then you'll become old and you'll have nothing, you know, your hearing will go and eyesight will go, nothing will be there. Okay, is it clear? So, you are in a very, very wonderful position of a householder's life. And after crossing middle age, okay, you have gone through midlife crisis also. What is midlife crisis, you know? See, what happens is when child is young, he has a lot of hopes. He has I'll conquer the world. Okay? Right? He'll have a lot of hopes. By the time, and then I'll have a good job, wonderful job, all dreams. So he is married, he has a good job. Okay, now he's come to middle age. Now you understood all dreams are unreal. They are all dreams. Now, past is unreal, future is also not hopeful. So that's called midlife crisis. Past is gone, future is also not bright. So now what will do? Then most of the people turn spiritual, like that what's happening here. So others who will come to spiritual class? Happen than the class, you tell me. Okay. So you are wonderful. What I'm saying, what his question is, how much time I have to do? Don't worry about how much time, how long. If you are clear that this is the right process, be in that. Okay. If you are not clear that this is the right process, you find the right process. Because end result, don't worry about that. If you are in the right process, day by day you start feeling more relieved. Okay. Day by day you start feeling more and more freer. If you are in the wrong process, you still feel suffering. Then you change the process. This may not, jnana may not be the process. You may find out some other process. In the jnana process, you be there, shravana, manana, nididhyasa, you keep continuing. Do a little bit of contemplation, little bit of nididhyasa. Then day by day you start feeling more and more free. What are the signs of being free, feeling free? First sign is, anything happening in life, you will not get disturbed much. The disturbance will come down. One husband and wife attended my class. They are 50-55 type of husband wife. They told, after this class, they told, before coming to the class, if anything happens in the house, the 1 week, there will be fight. Husband and wife will not see the face each other. Okay? So stress will be there for 1 week. Cool down. Now we have improved our Guruji a lot. 5 minutes, we are cooled down. Again, we are back. So your period of stress in the mind will come down. Your balance, you'll be lost. Balance you may lose because of your past impressions. Okay? But now you'll come back to center quickly, very fast. That's one sign. Okay? You may lose balance. So you don't worry. When I'm ultimately realized, don't worry about that. Day by day, you see these signs. One is any stress in life. A lot of things. That outer condition will be there. But your response to that, earlier you're losing balance earlier, now you'll lose a little bit and come back. Okay? Then your emotional response for any situation will come down. You'll be more and more calm. So anything which is calamity for other people, for you it appears as a happening. I mean, to give an example, one of my students' husband died. Everybody thought this lady will go crazy. On the other hand, everybody went crazy, but she was so calm and handling the situation. Okay. It may come to the extent such as that, oh, husband has died, this lady doesn't even put a shed a tear. That may have come to that also. But that amount of balance will be there. Any calamity in life. Okay. This is, I'm not thinking of ultimate realization. These are all side effects which are happening. Okay. Then any loss in life doesn't appear to be very big for him. There may be loss of job, loss of everything happens, but somewhere deep inside you feel very calm. That calmness will come. Okay. Then your understanding of the other person will be much better. You start understanding the other person much better. Okay? That's what my Gayatri told me today. She is able to understand the other person much better.
Other person means who? Husband or others?
Anyone. I'll tell you why. A person was going on the street. Somebody starts shouting at him and throwing a stone and hit him with a chappal. This guy gets very hurt. Okay, he starts fighting with that person runs away. Then this person has come home and started boiling and cursing that person. Then one of fresh friend came. He saw this person and, hey, do you meet that person? That person showed at you? Yes. Why do you worry about that person? Yeah? That person is mad. He does the same thing to everybody. Poor fellow. Immediately this anger goes. Perception changed. Understand? Huh? So now you are able to forgive that person. You are no longer feeling bad about the person. Now, look at yourself. You are getting angry, you are getting jealousy, you are getting hatred. Is it any different than mad person? So you start forgiving yourself first. It's a mad person in the end, okay. So you learn how to forgive yourself. Otherwise, you keep on cursing yourself. I should not have got angry. Okay, why did I make the friend with this person? Why did I talk to like this? So your self-blaming game will start coming down. Because mind is always mad only. Madness is called mind. Okay? So you start forgiving that mad fellow called mind. Then once you start forgiving that mad fellow kind, you will have a peace with yourself. Once you have peace with yourself, you will have peace with others also. You see that madness in you also. Oh, you are coming and talking to me like that? Earlier I was getting angry. How can you talk like that? Then I understand. Mad fellow in you is talking like that. So, I don't know whether you realize God, but you start realizing madness. Self-realization means whether you realize the self or I don't know. But you start understanding madness of the mind. Well, that's yourself now. So once you're understanding madness in you and you start accepting that madness, okay, this guy is mad like that, huh? Okay, let it be like that, I am Brahman. So you start detaching from the madness, you know, then you start forgiving yourself. I should not have done this like that, I should have done this like that, all those things, blah blah blah, will come down. Then now you don't get angry with anybody, because everybody, you're everywhere, you don't, I don't know whether you see God or not, you see madness everybody. Huh?
I see it
every day. So, what will happen? Because you see madness and because you are forgiving your madness in you start forgiving others also. My dear, you think spirituality is about God? Spirituality is about madness. Recognizing the madness called mind. Okay? So, once you start detaching from your mad mind, you start understanding other people also. Somebody comes and shouts at you, don't get angry. You look at, oh, this is one different type of madness. That's all. I know this variety. sitting in the position of guru, I have a privilege. Actually, I get new varieties every day. So what happens? You start recognizing madness is called mind. Then you start accepting the nature of the mind as it is. Then you start feeling peaceful. Right now, you are fighting with your mind. And you are fighting with other people's mind. Stop the fight. Don't have to worry about the fight. You find out what is the source of the mind. Atma. It has nothing to do with the mind. So you start becoming free. This is how you gradually become free. Don't ask when I will get enlightened, because there's no answer for that, because enlightenment is not an event in time. It's not a process. It's not an event at all. It's a non-event. See.
So should I say, how long will I be mad, or let me be mad anyway, it doesn't matter?
That you'd ask her. How long have you been? Every time when you touch your vididhyasa, you are becoming free from the madness. So now, how deep is your madness? How wide is your madness? I don't know. But we are touching the root of madness called I sense. So any other treatment will be only working at the surface level. Here we are pulling the base, okay, pulling the carpet under that. So the more clarity you get, the more it will collapse. It's not a function of how much time or how long, it's a clarity. Okay, so dhyana is not an independent activity. Dhyana and dhyana are two wings of the word. So you have to keep listening to get the clarity, depth, absolute clarity. So that help you get established in nidhyasana. So don't, when will I get enlightened is a wrong question, because
you are already that,
right? So it's almost like, the question is like this, you are sleeping, and the dream you became a seeker, okay? And you are seeking all places, I want to get enlightenment, you want to guru, and ask guru, when will I get enlightened? Okay, so guru says, just do this practice, you'll get enlightened, because the person who is asking is not real. Question who is asking is the ego, it's not real. So pseudo person will never get enlightened. Okay? The dream character will never get enlightened. Okay? The waking up from the dream character is called enlightenment. Now, the time is also dream time. Okay, it's not real. Waking up also is not real. Because already the sleeping person who has nothing has happened to you. The Atma, nothing has happened. So the question of event, enlightenment as an event is actually has no meaning. It's not an event in time and space. Okay? The moment you get enlightened, you realize that you are never unenlightened. You are Atma. So you are shifting the domain. the question in this domain will not be relevant to the other domain. So then what happened? This Buddha got enlightened and all. That's all purpose of, for the purpose of communicating society. Really, the woke up. It's called awakening. Okay, a sleeping person woke up. The dream cannot disappear. Okay, now all that question you can ask is, am I on the right path? Okay, so for your kind information, there are three paths possible for you. This is Jnana Marga. Then there is Upasana Marga. Okay, then there is a Yoga Marga. There is a Raja Yoga, there is Kundalini Yoga, so many variety of Yoga Marga. So there are different paths. This Jnana Marga is considered as the ultimate and direct path. Rest of the paths are all taking a longer time, and there are a lot of beautiful, lot of good things they feel good about it, life is feeling better, and all those things, they are experiences. Okay, those experiences are short-lived, they are not permanent. This is going beyond the experience. So if you think that this path is not suitable for you, choose some other path, but be on one path. Okay. So the sign of what is happening, I'll tell you, I have told you. Then what is sign of an enlightened being or Jnani? Tell me, what is the sign of enlightened being?
Laughing.
Laughter. Right? So there are no external signs for enlightened being. Zero. Okay? What happened normally because of our social conditioning, what of our TVs and serials and Puranas, the enlightened being, we have a specific characteristic. What is that? The beard. So, there is a theorem. The depth of your environment is proportional to the length of your beard. So, that's why people will longer and longer beard, longer and longer, more and more enlightened. So, all those things won't work.
And all the followers also will have to.
Yeah, will have that. Okay, so let them have. But what I'm saying is, the enlightenment cannot be observed or measured by outer conditions. Okay, it is not dependent on caste, creed, or sex. As many women are enlightened as men are. Okay. In fact, possibly more. But that signs are not visible, they don't show off. They're just silent and quiet. They'll keep their life themselves. Nobody will come and say, I'm enlightened, and nobody will say that. Only few people, what will happen? They may take the responsibility for teaching. Then they may be exposed to the society as people have some wisdom. Okay. So that also the society doesn't accept. Because to accept enlightenment is very difficult for the society. I mean, it is like in the madhouse, somebody has become alright is a very big sorry for others.
Some problem is
it's abnormality. But believe me, enlightenment is very simple and it's more common than what you can think. Our social conditioning and religious conditioning has made us to believe that it's very exclusive and nothing like that. Okay? There can be many, many more enlightened people than you think in the street, the hotels, in the security guards, at your home. There can be. And nobody will show off. They just become silent. So he's enlightened, that's why I say enlightened person is very ordinary. Unenlightened person is very extraordinary. He thinks he is extra superior. I am better. I am superior. Enlightened person, I am ordinary. I am existence. Okay? So he becomes normal, natural. Only in case some people take up certain responsibility in life, like teaching, or maybe ruling a kingdom, then something may catch to become. Otherwise, they become beautiful poets. Some of them write beautiful poetry, some of them sing beautifully, but nobody will know that they are enlightened. Okay? In many of the Kannada poets, okay, so much of enlightenment is oozing in their words, in their talks. They are definitely enlightened. But they don't say, they just write, they'll do the job. So enlightenment is nothing, is not a degree to be shown off. In fact, don't show it to anybody, just keep it to yourself. And never open your mouth and say, I am Brahman, I am Shiva to somebody else other than here. Okay? And you'll be in deep trouble. Okay? This is not something to tell to others. And don't go and start teaching to others. Okay? It has to come to a person whom they consider as guru. Even though you know I am not the doer and all, never talk to anybody. This all teaching is only for you. You learn, you practice, and this thing. You may teach something to them, but if you reach to level of a jnana, atmadjnana, whether you become Sadguru, that universe will decide. But as you keep doing some service to the society, whatever service you can do. But never show off. Never tell anybody that I am Brahman, I am Shiva, nothing like that. This understanding is only for yourself. Keep it to yourself. Okay? The moment you start speaking whatever spiritual truth you have learned here to talk to somebody, they will start confusion. They will start revolting against you. Okay? If they have to learn, when their time comes, they will have to come to go to a master teacher, master is that, and they have to learn. That's how it is. It's called Shankadinda Mandari Tirtha. Okay? So don't start, oh, I have learned and I spirituality and I'll teach everybody. Don't do that. But whatever is possible for you, keep doing some service. But don't confuse. Right? Don't tell people this is Maya. Don't tell anything. Okay? Don't do that. Don't do spiritual learning is only for yourself. You be peaceful. Right? Do whatever work you want to do. A jnani, okay, is considered as, okay, one who is in the waking state, dreaming state, deep sleep state, he never forgets that he is Atman, the self, he is Brahman, awareness is there. Okay? The dream quality will change. He will also have a dream, but in dream also, he will be aware that this is a mind. With his eyes open, he will be aware that this is Maya. Okay? So his self-awareness or self-nature of self is not forgotten any time. That will happen only when you start practicing Shravana Mana Nidhyasa continue over and again. Is it right? Then a jnani is in any situation he doesn't forget. When he is with the scholars, he may argue scholarly. When he is with the common man, he will be a common man. When he is doing business, he may do business. So, in variety of situations in life, he will adapt very easily. Okay? But we have a thing in the road, the jnana, atma jnana means you will run away from life. That's not. Vedanta or atma jnana is not for making you run away from life. Vedanta or atma jnana is to be in the life and face life in a better way. This is a very, very wrong understanding of Vedanta teaching. Okay, actually it is bringing sanity into your life. It is not making you run away from life as if life is some disease. No, I don't want to. See, these are all coming from the wrong understanding of teaching. Okay, wrong understanding. It's not like that. Wherever you are, you will be in a better way to handle life. More calmer, more peaceful way you will handle life. No, Vedanta means many people, oh, I'll go to a mountain and I'll leave the house and all. That's all actually false images created by social conditioning. See, in a given situation, you understand this unreal and you know your peace inside. You'll be able to handle any situation in a much more beautiful way compared to other people. Why should you run away from any situation?
Well, there is existence, there's nowhere to go.
You can't go. Nowhere to go. Alright? Nowhere to go. So now what will happen? People means spiritual person means what? One is, first the question is, he has to be very serious. Actually 10 years back I was conducting class in one place. There are some 40, 60 people and then there was a feedback form fill up. So feedback form was one for one. I know Prabhuji is in bliss, sir. But my request for Prabhuji, sincere request for Prabhuji, is that when he talks about serious matter, he should not laugh.
Spirituality
is serious. So the spirituality means people have understanding very serious. Okay? So that's why my videos, many people don't see, watch my videos. So-called very serious spiritual people. Okay? It's okay. What I'm saying is the spirituality is laughing at life. Earlier you were crying in life. Now you understand the paradox of life. You start laughing.
Andrew Cohen has a chuckle.
Chuckle.
Always. Always a chuckle.
So, you just feel free. And see, it's almost like you are watching a horror movie. You forget that it's a horror movie and start getting involved in that and start seeing something is happening to me. Suddenly you start, oh, this is a movie. Now the same horror movie looks very nice. Hey, director is very nicely. Yeah, that actor is very acting very well. like that you start seeing life as good actors, okay, and you start appreciating life, and your appreciation of life will become much better, and you start laughing in life instead of crying in life. If you are thinking that spirituality is something very serious, you have to go to mountain and run away from house, that's not this spirituality at all. Okay, so you start feeling relaxed in any situation, and you start laughing at the madness of the mind, madness of the world. Right? To the extent people may think you are mad because you are laughing. Okay. So then instead of crying, you are laughing. I don't know whether I told you about the story of a laughing monk. Laughing Buddha. So there's a statue, no? There's a big belly and laughing. It's called Laughing Buddha. So he's a Zen monk. Zen monk means in Japan, Zen monastery is there. The monastery, they joined monastery for enlightenment. They work very hard. They get up at 4:30 in the morning, meditate. Then typically monastery will be on top of the hill. They'll come down, fetch water. It's very hard life. 7 days a week they have to meditate. They chant mantras. Very, very tough life. In search of enlightenment. So somebody has spent about 20 to 30 years like that, very hard life, hoping that one day or the other day enlightenment happens. Suddenly, and he has memorized all the sutras, Zen sutras, everything. Suddenly, one day he had enlightened all this foolishness of this, mithya nature is understood. Then he started laughing. And first thing is he went and burnt all the Zen books which he has learned. Then throughout his life, he kept on laughing. And village after village, he went in Japan and laughing. And the people called him Laughing Buddha. And in his honor, that statue is made. The big belly represents, he is full of bliss and he keeps on laughing. So that statue is, if you keep in house, it is considered as auspicious. Why it is auspicious? At least so serious you people are look at him and laugh sometime. That's all is auspicious. Others will think that some luck will come.
You're supposed to rub his belly also, didn't you?
You're
supposed to rub his belly.
Rub his belly also. So, if you have any concept of enlightenment other than laughter, okay, the best sign of enlightenment is you start laughing at life. That's what is enlightenment. If you think enlightenment is some experience, finally it will translate into laughter. And smile on your face. That's all. Oh, enlightenment is not a new experience. Every experience in life, you start laughing at life. Okay? That's enlightenment. And an enlightened person will be in the same, will not be disturbed in any situation. To the extent they say, he is with the scholars or he is with the thieves. Or he is with the, householders or the monks. He is comfortable in all situations. Okay? Because he understands the nature of life. Raw nature of life is understood.
He's flexible.
He'll act appropriately, as actions are more appropriate. Not overreaction, not underreaction. He'll do act appropriately. So if you have, any of you have an idea that spirituality means running away from life, it is false. Okay? Then, realizing I am Brahmasmi is one aspect. Then finally it has to translate into everywhere is Brahman only. Sarvam Kali the Brahma has to come. Okay? The realization doesn't stop at I am Brahman. Realization has to come to the level with your eyes open, you should be able to live in a Brahman consciousness. That will happen. As gradually the truth sinks in, as you start doing Nididhyasa meditation, it will happen. Okay? So, there's a freedom for the enlightened. This freedom you have to understand. This is called the Sthita Pradna. Okay? People don't understand. Even many people have written commentaries on that. Really, what will happen is, you can say, I am the body. And experience the world as I am the body. You can say, I am the mind and experience the world as I am the mind. I am happy, unhappy is all experience of mind. You can say, I am Sakshi and be detached. And you can say, I am Brahman and sit in a samadhi or a sahaja samadhi. World is disappearing. Right? There are four possible situations. Correct? A jnani is able to go from one to other very easily and come back. You move in and out.
Seamlessly.
There's no, like changing a gear, you can go here and there. Okay? You understand what I'm saying? Whereas Ajnani is stuck with only one thing, I am the body. Or I am the mind. A yogi is only stuck with something, samadhi. Whereas a Jnani is able to comfortably move in all the four, anytime, he is roaming. Okay, that's why it's called Paramahamsa. Okay, Paramahamsa has become a title.
So many people are given this title.
They are given the title, but what is Paramahamsa means? Somebody is able to go to any state of consciousness in and out easily. Okay, one state of consciousness, I am the body. Second state of consciousness, I am the mind. Third state of consciousness, I am witness. Fourth state of consciousness, I am Brahman. Sakshi. Four, right? Somebody who is able to comfortably move in all these four only is called Paramahamsa or Jnani. Okay? You have heard of this word called Hamsa? Hamsa Vidme Paramahamsa Dhimahi Tanno Hamsa Prajodayat.
Hamsa. Ask God, no, every day we are praying for that.
Who is we? Hamsa Hamsaya Vidmahe. Know that Hamsa. What is Hamsa? Ahamsaha. Your breath makes a sound. Hamsa. Hamsa is called Jiva. Hamsa Hamsaya Vidmahe. Know that Hamsa. In last 10 classes is only, you know, I am telling you what is Hamsa. Okay, your mind.
So Vidmahe
and no. Vidmahe. Paramahamsa Dhimahi. Let me think of Paramahamsa. Means Paramahamsa is one is Jnani who has become free. Okay, Hamsa is able to, Hamsa is swimming. Okay. Hamsa has a special capability. It is able to separate milk from water. Paramahamsa is somebody who has used that ability to separate out what? Nitya Anitya. Real and unreal, Satya and Mithya, and Atma and Anatma. Okay? So this separation he does, and he gets established, I am Brahman. Okay? Now if he is stuck as Brahman, then he is not Jnani. He is not stuck as Brahman. He can operate in any of these four. Then all is free. Oh, I am Brahman only, I can't do anything, it's not Jnani. Not good enough. The Brahman can take the form of Jiva and he can come back. That's why he's Paramahamsa. He's able to swim easily in the something called life, samsara. Okay. So he is able to take the position of I am the body. When?
When he needs
transaction. He'll do, I am the body. No. Somebody, something has to be done. No, I am Sakshi. It doesn't work. Right? So imagine you become Paramahamsa tomorrow and husband is coming. I am Sakshi. So you have to immediately take the position of a wife and assume the body position and operate. But person, outside person doesn't know. So you have to operate. And very well you know that I am Brahman, but I am operating. Okay, so then somebody will say nice food for you. Okay, very nice food. I am Sakshi. Enjoy food, yeah. Okay, that's why the model for you for a Jnani is Krishna. Any situation is enjoy. Okay, somebody gives food, somebody gives calls for dancing, somebody calls for music, somebody asks for Jnana, somebody comes for war. Everything. Okay, don't the model, you have to be very clear what is Jnani's model. Jnani is Krishna, is called Paramatmani. He is this thing. Any situation in life, you will be able to adapt. Very well knowing all the time that you are a Brahman. And nobody will know externally. If the moment somebody else knows, you are in trouble. And that means actually you are showing off. So then, second situation where he is there is a mind. So some nice music is there. Enjoy. No, I am detached from the mind. I don't want to enjoy music. Not. Be enjoy. At the same time, something disturbance happens. Immediately, Jnani will become Sakshi. See what is required. And immediately take the position of body and act. So this switching happens within Jnani. Very easily. Is that clear? Okay. And outside people will not know this gear shifting. Right? When some disturbance comes, calamity comes, he'll watch carefully because he's Sakshi. Then, what is to be done? He'll take the position of the body and do it. Okay. Jnani is able to move in and out of all the four states of consciousness. That's why it's called Jnana. and nobody will know. There's no external science for that. Okay. So now the question comes, if you say so, there are great jnanis like Ramana Maharshi, they are sitting like that. Okay. So why, what is the difference between jnanis? There are four levels of jnanis. Okay. I'll repeat. Brahmavid, Brahmavara, Brahmavarenya, and Brahmavarishta. Okay. So anybody who has understood Atmadnana, got Atmadnana, and is able to do Nididhyasa and realize that I am. Nididhyasa you can do only when you realize you are Brahman. Nididhyasa is not doing Nididhyasa and getting Brahman. Nididhyasa is after Dhana I am Brahman only, you are standing. Okay? So then such a person is called Brahmavid. He is knower of Brahman. Knower of Brahman. He knows. But he doesn't show to anybody. Okay? He will interact in the society, he will work in the society for Loka Kalyan, service to the society. Atmanu Mokshartam Jagadhitayaja. People, nobody will know. And such persons have become kings. Okay? Such persons have become kings, emperors. They will do, they will not show anything and they will do what is right and what is good for the country. And we have such prime minister today. Okay? He's a jnani. He's a real person. Realized person as well can go and sit in a cave. Okay? But these people take up a responsibility, say that I will help the society. So for that helping the society, they have to act in the society in a very equanimous way, very balanced way, and do work. So they come back to the this thing. Such a person is called Brahmavid. Nobody knows they are Brahmavid. Okay? Then comes Brahmavara. Brahmavara, what happens? He starts becoming more detached. Okay, his interaction with society comes down. Okay, his interaction with the society comes down. See, to interact and do service to the society, you need vasanas. Okay, your pending vasanas are there. Right, you have vasana. What vasana? Before realization, you had selfish vasana. I want this, I want it. But also you had a, I want to serve the world. I want to help people. That desire is there. Okay. So that is called Loka Kalyana, Vasana for Loka Kalyana. So that Vasana is there and that Vasana is not gone. That's why they come back and they start serving the society a very hard way. For example, Swami Chinmayananda came back from Himalayas to teach. Buddha went back to teach. Okay, they start serving the society because they have a Vasana for Loka Kalyana. That's why what they do, they don't spend more time on transcendental Brahman state. Every day they go back. Every day go back. And he will come back. Okay? You understand? They don't suddenly, but Brahmavara, what happens? He starts interaction with the society, starts coming down. So here what's happening here is the moment you go to Brahman, the ego is getting stretched in one way. Ego is getting dissolved. And the moment you come to society, ego is getting stretched. There's a push and pull is happening. Okay? So the vasana for samsara, loka kalyana also starts coming down. When you reach the certain level. For example, Vivekananda, he had a desire to establish Ramakrishna mission. Okay, he established Ramakrishna mission, administration work. And after that, his desire for loka kalyana went down. He started going to Himalayas. So what happens is this part, vasana, loka kalyana vasana also starts coming down. So then they start becoming detached. Brahmavara, Brahmavid, Brahmavara. Brahmavarenya, they start completely detachment world. They spend more time in samadhi, what you call Brahman state, okay, samadhi state, because they know they this thing has come down. Brahma Varishta, what will happen? He is not able to interact with society because vasanas to interact with society is zero, practically. That's what Ramana Maharshi is. Okay, there's nothing. So then for him, the society, local area of society, people come to me, I'll give you dana, that's all. I don't go anywhere, I don't do anything. That's jnana. So what happens is the difference between Brahmavid, Brahmavara, Brahmavarini and Brahmavarishta is how much desire they have for Loka Kalyana is the difference. Understand? This is a vasana. So for people like, for saints like Ramana Maharshi, their vasana is zero, practically. I mean, not Loka Kalyana, I don't have to do Loka Kalyana. I'll do Loka Kalyana, but I don't go and do something for that. People will come to me. Okay. So there are four types of jnani. Brahmavid, Brahmavara, Brahmavarini, Brahmavarishta. Who is greater of these four?
No, because it's universal.
It's all same. only Brahman, all of them are Brahman realized.
Functions
are different. But for people, Brahma Varishta appears to be great. That's why he's called Brahma Varishta. Oh, this person is not sitting, he's not going anything. It's great. In reality, the other person is there who is working 18 hours a day for 7 days a week for country. So he doesn't appear to be Dnani, he appears like a prime minister. So he's a Brahmavid.
That is universal energy operates. Whatever is required for the universe, it operates.
So Brahmavid, Brahmavara, Brahmavarinde, Brahmavarishta, all are Dnanis. There's no difference. Okay? But their functions are different. Depending on how much vasana they have. So many people do sadhana. I want to help people. I want to do loka kalyana. I want to reduce suffering of this thing. Their vasana will be very strong.
Mm-hmm.
That vasana will take them to do service. My vasana is, I want to make the spiritual teaching simpler for people. That's my vasana. That's my sadhana. Okay? So that's what I have been continuously focusing on. That's why I keep teaching. So is it clear? So Brahmavid, Brahmavara, Brahmavarinde, Brahmavarishta, they are not different in jnana. But they are different in the manifestation, in terms of the desire for loka kalyana. Okay? So please understand, everybody has a selfish desire. So the selfish desire of person on the sadhana, he says, Atmano Mokshartam Jagadidayacha, for my self-realization and service to the world. Okay? There are many people who have intense desire to help service to the world. Atmano Mokshartam is for the means to that. So that, what happens to them? After realization also, they want to... Okay, that's how it is. Are you clear? Any questions? And I have given you symptoms, what will happen to you. And there's no other thing, no light coming, no joy, no song, no music, nobody will come and say, okay, you are enlightened, nothing, no apsaras will come and dance in front of you. Nothing of that will happen. There are all some descriptions are there like that. Okay? Okay? So that's why I'm there. People have a lot of... if not anything else, at least some apsaras should come and dance in front of me. Okay. I would like that, but that's a different thing. Right? So don't have any fantasies about this thing, because there are a lot of fantasies which are projected in TV and this thing. It is simple. Mind becomes more and more simpler and calmer and piece by piece, day by day. And understanding of life, nature becomes deeper and deeper and deeper every day. Okay? So this is Jnana Marga. In Yoga Marga, there will be some siddhis will come. Okay? Some special powers may come. Some extrasensory perception, some ability to... Don't get bogged down by that. Okay? They're all temporary. And all siddhis. But they are all temporary. They are all mind. Okay? Enlightenment means no mind. Okay? So they're all powers which yogic powers, yogic siddhis. But yogic siddhis, Shiva says very clearly, if you want enlightenment, drop all those siddhis, drop the mind. Okay? So the world gets fascinated by siddhis. Okay? Enlightened person is simple. In his presence, some miracles may happen, but he doesn't know. Okay? It doesn't happen. It will happen just because of the universal consciousness, Shakti. Anything else?
Now the people who are siddhis and they use the siddhis, what happens to them? That's their downfall, isn't it?
See, what happens? See, the siddhis, we cannot say what really is happens to them. Okay? What happens is that the siddhis are mental powers. Okay? Mind becomes subtle. And yoga, as I told you, is concentration. Jnana is dropping, giving up. So here the intense concentration gives them powers. Now there are some people will start getting fascinated by the powers and they start exhibiting them and people start giving respect and they start getting money and something in return and they start falling. They'll fall, don't fall. Okay. So recently you heard one person was raided.
Yes, yes.
Right?
So, I met him years ago before he became what he became. He was in a school, a principal in a school.
I know. Jiva school. So what happens is some siddhis will come. They will bring money and power.
No, but he wanted that.
Huh?
He did it for the power and money.
No.
He was very clear of what he wanted.
No. I'm not speaking of him. I'm speaking of generally.
Generally.
Okay. So what happens is that siddhis will bring you money, power, fame.